Time now for your forecast first. WRBL News 3 First Alert Weather.
The clouds have cleared out across the area. The sun is out. Temperatures got into the 60s this afternoon, and we're talking about some cooler conditions as we head into this evening with those clear skies. Temperatures are going to be dropping into the 40s, and we're talking about temperatures right around the low 40s by the time you wake up. But we're still tracking changes over the next 3 days, especially over the weekend. We'll talk about that storm system coming up. You're watching WRBL News 3 on your side.
Straight ahead, a major break in the 45-year-old cold case of a missing Auburn University student.
Next, authorities searching for a suspect who fled from a traffic stop on Interstate 85.
Wow, 6 years in the making, Holiday Heroes. Oh, what does it all mean?
Come out and support Holiday Heroes!
So we're going to tell you how you can help someone who's in need this holiday season. It's all coming up in a live report at Rivertown Ford. The news starts right now.
On your side. This is News 3 First Edition.
Good evening and thank you for trusting News 3. I'm Phil Scoggins.
And I'm Teresa Whitaker. A new discovery in a 45-year-old cold case is leading Troup County officials to search for new answers.
News 3's Amanda Peralta has the story.
22-year-old Kyle Klingscales vanished into thin air on the night of January 27, 1976. He was a LaGrange native who was studying at Auburn University and working at the Moose Club, a lounge off Old Airport Road in LaGrange. Klingscales disappeared that Friday night, leaving few clues and little hope behind him. 45 years later, his car, a white two-door 1974 Pinto runabout with a Georgia tag, his wallet, and human remains believed to be his, were found in Chambers County, Alabama, off County Road 83.
We retrieved the vehicle out of the creek, was able to tell that it had a Troup County tag on it. Once we were able to tell the Troup County tag was on it, I then reached out to Captain Nathan Taylor, gave him the tag number and the VIN number, to attempt to try to find the information on this tag.
Klingscales' parents spent years searching for their only son and even wrote a book titled Kyle's Story, Friday Never Came, The Search for Missing People, and created a nonprofit missing person organization, Find Me, Inc. Officials say his mother's biggest wish was to find her son before she passed away. His mother, Louise, passed away this past January.
Hopefully we'll find something we may never know, but we are glad today. You know, Ms. Klingscale, his mother, died just this year in January, and it was always her hope that he would come home. It was always our hope that we would find him for her before she passed away. So just the fact that we have hopefully found him and the car brings me a big sigh of relief.
The car was transported to the Troup County Sheriff's Office, where the GBI will be investigating the contents of the car.
This is the creek where officials located Kyle Klingscales' car, leaving them searching for answers regarding his disappearance. Reporting in Chambers County, Amanda Peralta, WRBL News 3, on your side.
Previous news coverage indicates two people, Jimmy Jones and Gene Johnson, were later arrested on various charges connected to Klingscales' death. However, neither was charged with his murder.
News 3 has contacted the Troup County District Attorney for more information regarding arrests made in the case, and we will update you if and when new details are available. You can head to WRBL.com for more on this 45-year-old cold case. Meanwhile, also in Troup County, authorities searching for a person who they say ran from a traffic stop on Interstate 85. Officials from the Troup County Sheriff's Office say deputies were performing a traffic stop on a vehicle from Coweta County on I-85 South when the individual ran off into a wooded area. Multiple law enforcement officers are currently on the scene searching for that individual. Stay with News 3 on air and online as we continue to gather more details.
In Muskogee County, a man currently in jail on multiple charges, including felony theft, will soon be extradited to Alabama on a capital murder charge. Dothan police say 19-year-old Solomon Cooper is listed as a person of interest in the deadly shooting of 20-year-old Sincere Tyson in October. After many search warrants and subpoenas issued by Dothan police, Cooper is charged with one count of capital murder burglary. Cooper was arrested last month on separate charges of theft by receiving stolen property and other offenses. Once those charges are addressed in Georgia, Cooper will be extradited to Dothan to face the murder charge. In Alabama, he will be held without bond. More charges are expected at a later date.
Switching gears now, News 3 is leading a community effort to help those in need this Christmas.
It's the mission of our 6th annual Holiday Heroes campaign. It made its latest stop today at Rivertown Fort on Whittlesey Road in Columbus.
And that's where we find News 3's chief meteorologist Bob Jeswalt, who joins us live with more of today's donation drive.
Hey, Bob.
Fantastic. I mean, it is great. The toys are coming in, but gently worn items like hats, gloves, scarves for Valley Rescue Mission, Santa's Castle. We need some gift cards for teenagers, and of course, unwrapped gifts for toys for some of the kids on post. And of course, our wonderful kids here from Hardaway, they did great. Our cadets, they're not kids, these are cadets, young adults, and they've done a fantastic job of leading the way and being good stewards of trying to raise some awareness with that. What do you have to say about that? Oh, I got him trained. They keep saying the same thing, and Santa Claus is happy too. But our presenting sponsor here today is Daniel Appliance, and of course, we're thankful for our host too, right here at Rivertown Ford. We're going to talk with Brad Williams in just a moment. But first, let's talk to John Foy, our other sponsor here today, who really loves getting behind this action, and Greg Wilson from Valley Rescue Mission. This is what they had to say.
And our generous donors make this happen. Again, a monetary donation, a toy, a blanket, anything you can do will help our great community.
For Valley Rescue Mission, it's very, very important. You know, we are in a very busy time of the year, a busy Christmas and holiday season, but people are in need. People are in need in our community, and for individuals who choose and make the choice to actually donate, whether it be toys or clothing, blankets, you name it, to Valley Rescue Mission through Holiday Heroes is very vital. We, in turn, just simply give that those items right back to the community.
Well, thanks a lot, Greg and John. Take a look. If we'll part a little bit here for a second, look at the toys coming in here. That brings to mind Greg was talking about Valley Rescue Mission. And, of course, Amy Gill, how are you?
Good.
She's with Santa's Castle on post. So important that our kids do not go undervalued, underappreciated. Families are going through a lot. You got to remember these enlisted folks that are coming in on post too. A lot of times, a lot of kids. We got to make sure that they're not forgotten.
That's correct. We have anywhere between 400 to 1,000 kids that we serve, anywhere from 0 to 18 years of age.
That's fantastic. And gift cards are something good to have.
They are for our older kids. It's real hard to find some gifts that they want. So.
And, of course, this jacket may speak volumes. It's loud, but, you know, here he is. Look at us. Brad Williams, of course, general manager right here at Rivertown Ford. Thanks for hosting today. But, Brad, you got a big, big heart. You always do. And it shines right through your jacket.
Thank you for that, Bob. It's no worry. Listen, this is an easy decision to make to be able to host for Holiday for Heroes. There is such great charities here to support Santa's Castle. A lot of these people, this is going to be the only toys under the Christmas tree. When you got the Valley Rescue Mission, I mean, these coats, these jackets, the things, I mean, it was cold this morning, and
absolutely,
there's a lot of people,
yeah,
that are cold. They need that help. The food that we're collecting that you can see behind us, a lot of that time, that's going to be the only food on the table for Christmas this year. And you do the right thing to make sure these heroes are doing the right thing, to make sure that this is going to the right people and the people that need it. And that's where you come into play. And where you guys come into play is to helping, to bring it down. I know right now you're thinking, you know, maybe I can bring it tomorrow. There's just, bring it now.
Yeah.
You know, they need it now. We need coats. We need jackets. We need food. We need toys. That's what we're looking for. And you can trust that it's going to people who actually need it.
Ralph Whittlesey, Phil and Teresa, you know that till 6:30, as Brad just said. Amy, down here, cadets, what do you say?
Come out and support Holiday Heroes.
I can't say it enough. Back to you.
All right. Great job, Bob. We'll check back in a little bit later on.
As we head into the break, we want to thank you again for trusting News 3.
Cody, we'll have your full forecast coming up right after the break.
your side. Meteorologist Cody Nickel has your first alert forecast.
Welcome back. We got up to 62 degrees and also at the airport, just over a half inch of rain with the morning showers and storms. But outside right now, we're in the upper 50s, 57 in Columbus, 55 for Auburn and Opelika, still some middle 60s out across parts of Americas. But overall, the frontal boundary is through, but we're going to be watching the tail end of this frontal boundary kick back up as a warm front as we go throughout really tomorrow. Tomorrow's going to be a transition day. We're not expecting any rain, just partly sunny skies throughout your Thursday as the warm front lifts back up through the north or towards the north. Really overnight Thursday into Friday morning is when it moves through the area, and you can also see that chance of rain does slowly creep back in the forecast for your Friday. Friday's going to be somewhat overcast, mostly cloudy, off and on showers as the boundary just lifts off towards the north and up towards the northeast here, and this is going to set the stage for Saturday. Saturday, we are weather aware as we're going to be tracking the chance for severe storms that will move across the southeast and into our area as the frontal boundary pushes through. So early by Friday at 5 a.m., you can see a good line of thunderstorms from Memphis down through parts of Shreveport. That's going to be moving eastward and eventually into our neck of the woods sometime Saturday afternoon, Saturday evening. That is when we're going to see the greatest coverage of showers from that system. So for your Friday, just some isolated showers off and on, and the greatest chance comes with the front as the frontal system pushes into our area, so scattered to likely widespread. And then after that, we're going to start to clear and have some sunnier but also cooler conditions back in the first alert forecast. So overnight tonight, a low about 40 degrees, clear and cool, and those winds will go calm. Tomorrow, we're going to be in the middle 60s, partly sunny, somewhat seasonable. And tomorrow's going to be a transition day. So if you need to get something outside done, get it done before Friday comes with off and on showers as that warm front lifts in. Saturday, weather aware, showers and storms. And we should clear for Sunday, and that's going to bring the sunny conditions and cooler temperatures back for next week. Phil and Teresa.
All right. Thanks so much, Cody. Time now to head back out to Rivertown Ford for more from our Holiday Heroes campaign.
Well, I got to tell you something. Phil and Teresa, Cody, everybody, this has been a great day. The weather, as you just heard, turned out perfectly. We got Christine Hall. She is the principal at Hardaway High School, and they're led by some great leaders who served our country. The best thing is when you see them at this age, young adults, they are our future leaders, no matter what, and they're always giving back. That's what military is all about. I asked our principal, who's been part of MEEF before, she's wonderful from the Muskogee County. She's so humble. She says, Bob, it's not about me, it's about these guys. So I'm going to go all the way down, and all my Mallory Bowners in the house, look at that, ready to rock and roll. Tell us why this is so important for the Hardaway JROTC cadets to do something like this.
This is so important to do this because we all need to give back to the community. Christmas time can be a very lonely time for people who don't have family, and especially children who don't have families as well, like orphans and such. But we all need to give back, so to not just think about ourselves and think about other people.
Wonderfully done. Give her a round of applause. Because I want, you know why I want to say this? Because Bowner was outside pacing a little bit, and her retired lieutenant, Colonel Mike Farrell, was out there. Hey, Bowner, get in here, he said with that gruff voice. And then your principal was like, she's going to be okay. She did great. Phil and Teresa did great. So I'm real proud of all of you, and it's important that we keep doing this, correct? Because, you know, collecting these items puts a little bit of warmness in your heart, right?
Yes.
Tell us, how does it warm your heart?
It warms my heart to think about other people because sometimes we get wrapped up in our own problems that we don't think about certain people. But doing this project made me think about there's other people out there that don't have everything for certain holidays and just in general, and that we all need to give back sometimes.
You looking for a job?
I have one.
She's a straight A student. Look at that. You can see on her bars here, Phil and Teresa. Wonderfully done. What do we say for everyone to do? To come on down to what?
Come and support our holiday heroes.
And Phil and Teresa, Santa Claus on cue will be here at 6 o'clock. You'll find out how he's given back to the military this time of year. Back to you.
All right, Bob, thank you so much. Stick with WRBL News 3.
We are back in 3 minutes.
on your side. You're watching WRBL News 3 First Edition.
The U.S. is quickly approaching 50 million COVID cases since the virus first appeared almost 2 years ago. But promising new data is revealing how well one vaccine may work to fight the Omicron strain.
Natalie Brand has the story.
But if you get the booster, you're really in good shape.
President Biden welcomed new data about Pfizer's coronavirus booster shot, which found it increases protection 25-fold against the Omicron variant compared to the initial two doses.
If ever there was a clarion call for people who are not vaccinated to get vaccinated and those who are vaccinated fully to get boosted, the new challenge with the Omicron variant clearly is that.
Cases of the highly contagious strain first detected in South Africa have now been reported in at least 20 U.S. states. Scientists say initial data shows the Omicron variant is less severe than the Delta variant. Delta is still driving a surge of infections and hospitalizations nationwide.
Unless we really double down on what we're doing, we could see an increased spike that goes even higher than that as we get deeper into December and January.
While the Omicron variant has sparked a rise in booster shots and vaccinations, a group of lawmakers wants to try and block President Biden's vaccinate or test rule, which would apply to millions of American workers.
Democratic Senators Joe Manchin and John Tester have said they support the Republican measure, which is expected to come up for a vote Wednesday.
I'm vaccinated. I encourage people to get vaccinated. But I don't believe that that's something the federal government can mandate.
The effort is largely symbolic since it's unlikely to come up for a vote in the House.
Our Republican friends are going to come to the floor to push an anti-science, anti-vaccine proposal.
The vaccine requirement for businesses of 100 or more employees is also facing legal challenges in the courts. Natalie Brandt, CBS News, Capitol Hill.
You're watching News 3 First Edition.
Cody will have a final look at that forecast when we come back.
Hurt by a big truck? 1-800-CALL-KEN.
One call, that's all.
on your side. You're watching WRBL News 3 First Edition.
Welcome back, everybody, to News 3 First Edition. I'm Chief Meteorologist Bob Jeswell. Holiday Heroes continues. Santa for Military Families will be coming up at 6, 5 Central. And Maya Bauner, I called her Mallory because I have a producer, Mallory. Poor Maya. We're going to hear back from her and how the JROTC cadets gave back big time. Take a look at some of the toys that they brought in for Santa's Castle here today. They've been collecting for several weeks. More on that coming up. Plus, Valley Rescue Mission. We're talking about toys for teenagers and kids, even gift cards and even clothes that will keep you warm. All that and much more right here off of Rivertown Ford, Whittlesey till 6:30. Please come on down. We're ready. I'm going to do this for Brad, where nobody ever walks away without a deal. How's that? For good stuff, right? Okay, so that's good. So I know it's always a lot of fun. So you're getting excited, aren't you?
Yes, sir.
You are, definitely. And I'm sorry about the name thing. Santa for Military Families is coming up, too. Give us a little hint, Santa.
We'll be right back.
No, listen to that. At 6, that's pretty good. We like all that. But Phil and Teresa, seriously, all day long, if we're talking about just gently used items as far as anything we're going to give to keep our hands warm, heads warm, jackets, and so much more. Back to you.
All right. Thanks so much, Bob. And thank you for watching News 3 First Edition.
We'll see you back here at the top of the hour.